Hello, my name is Heldin. I come from Tallinn and I work in a company called Bigbank. Yes, why you should listen to me at all? I have been connected to Agile since 2009. Have been working as a Scrum Master with several teams. Today I am responsible over the Agile process in Bigbank. Yes, so that's kind of my background. But before I go on, I would actually like to know your background. So how many of you, please raise your hand, is using Agile or kind of, you would say like kind of Agile? Scrum. So who of you actually use Scrum or kind of Scrum? That's the second question. So the other question is like, who is actually following the framework that is described in Agile guide, Scrum guide? So who is doing Scrum by Scrum guide? 100%. That's why I asked first, like, so which part you don't do is the question then. Okay. The other question, I was just wondering, how many of you are not from Riga? Please raise your hand. Okay. And how many of you are not from Latvia? Nice. Because just of the interest. So one of the things that I also do back in Estonia is that I also run a conference called Agile Saturday. What we recently also have, we also have one of the speakers sitting here. Okay, so about Bigbank. I don't know how many of you know about Bigbank. We are also in Latvia, but we are actually in 9 countries. Our loan portfolio with the 2015 end was 300 million euros. We have more than 400 employees. We have 80 people working in IT. And we started Scrum in 2014. And we currently have 9 Scrum teams, plus some others who don't use Scrum, but all development teams actually use Scrum. So this is something that from the beginning we already said that if you are a development team, you have to use Scrum. So how did our journey start? Chapter 1, try to do Agile. So what is try to do Agile actually all about, at least what I think? And I would say it's about following the rules. Learning the rules. By the way, I'm going to repeat a little bit about what the previous speaker was talking about, but I'm going to say we have done those mistakes in our cases. So 2014, when we hired a new CTO, this CTO came and said, okay, the way how you work sucks actually. And why is it sucks? Is that actually they were doing HIPPO development. Who knows what this HIPPO stands for? Highest paid person opinion. So that's how it goes. So basically they were like, we have 9 countries, so all of them wanted development things to be done. Then we also wanted to do something like just in general in IT, to kind of not only doing the maintenance, but actually doing something new also. And all of those things came to this one pile. And then this poor small development team started to do them one by one, but not one by one in a sense that we will start with one and delivering this one, but starting with one, then the next highest paid person came to the room and said, "Woo, you need to do this." And then they were like, okay, okay, you are like higher position than the previous guy. Okay, we will do what you said. So what do you think, how many things got done? almost like some things got done, but not enough. So when I joined in 2014 in fall to this Bigbank team, I went to marketing team, which were like all the countries marketing people together, and I said like, yay, next year I hope to see some IT people here as well. Actually, one country manager laughed out loud, saying that, I don't believe it, you're not going to deliver anything. This is our practice, this is what we know. So we understood that, okay, now we need to actually change it. So first of all, what we did was that we created product teams. So before we had general, we had teams, but they weren't specific to anything. So then we created, I think in the beginning we had five or six different product teams who were focusing concretely on specific product. The problem still was that there were so many dependencies between them, those teams, that but this still in the beginning, it was actually at least a start that, okay, already the people who ordered different things, they already started to kind of understand, okay, I need to go to this person to get this. It doesn't go to the same kind of one pail of or list of works that you will wait forever and most likely will never get. So that was the first step. Second step was that we needed Scrum Masters. So do you think we had any people in the company who actually had Scrum certification or any experience with Scrum? Of course you know, but did we have Scrum Masters? Absolutely. So basically how it looked like was that every team, they were like, okay, every team needs a Scrum Master, let's pick a Scrum Master. So usually the position went to a person who, by the team members, sometimes were least kind of valuable for them. And sometimes if there was someone who like had maybe participated some conference or have read more about Agile or Scrum, then that person got this position. I have to say, none of those people who first started as Scrum Masters are Scrum Masters today. They have either went back to their actual position or they have left the company. So this is kind of like what happened today. But on that time, that's how we started. And also we didn't have any, well, the CTO was the only person who actually had been part of the Agile team before. And everyone else only had heard about it. And they kind of had tried maybe some things, but not really. So then the pain of the change started. How many of you love changes? Please raise your hand. How many of you hate changes? And how many of those who hate changes are developers? So usually I would say that the development team, they don't like so much changes. And this was actually one of the pain that we kind of faced. And we are kind of facing it today also. The only certain things that we have is that there will be change. And we are still changing. In the beginning, it was even kind of worse because it was hard to keep the teams into like certain amount of people. So they didn't even have time to kind of really start to work as teams. So how many of you know about this different team development phases? Storming, forming, norming, half I would say. So the last one is performing, yes. And it's really hard to get there, I would say. So basically, first one is forming. When people come together and they are nice to each other and say like, hey, hello, my name is Heldin, like we are right now. Next one is storming. When I'm gonna say things that you disagree and you're gonna throw apples or tomatoes to me. that, hey, I hate you, like, why you always do this and that. Then it's going to be norming when we will be friends again. But then it takes a little bit more time to actually be performing, that we actually have synergy with each other and we can start moving towards. So actually, in the beginning, we were only on this forming and storming phase. And people were actually not so happy. They were happy that finally we have some changes, that it seems that we're gonna do better, because there was no hippo people going to scream to the development teams anymore. But still the changes were kind of hard for them. What happened next was that if you make a change, you should also inspect and adapt. How many of you do retrospectives? How many of you don't do retrospectives? How many of you do retrospectives regularly, meaning after every sprint? Okay, quite good. I usually say that retrospective is one of the most important meetings on Scrum. Why? Exactly the same things that I have here, inspect and adapt. How can you become better if you don't inspect? What did you do good and what did you do bad? And one of the things, for example, that came out from this inspect and adapt was that Scrum Masters cannot be doing both jobs. And why? Because if you are a developer or a tester, and there is like timing pushing you to deliver on time, then of course you don't do your Scrum Master work, because there is so many other things that you need to do. So this was one of the wins that we actually gained, that starting with this year, we actually decided that we will have full-time Scrum Masters that will be not any other role in the team. So, and I would say it was a great success that we decided this. And it's not only my gut feeling, but we actually saw it also on our measurements that this was like really good decision what we made regarding this. Going on regarding inspect and adapt also was this, that our, as I said before, our teams, they were so depending on each other. So what we started in the beginning of 2015 was that we created a meeting where all the product owners came together. We gave rough estimates to the epics or minimum viable parts of things that we want to deliver, and then they would say also that whose team helps they would also need. So we actually kind of mapped down all the dependencies in like a high level picture, and we looked quarterly kind of way into the future. And the first time when we did it in the beginning of January, we had lots and lots of dependencies. And we learned from this. So by the time we had the second time meeting, we had less of them already. But as you can understand, you cannot really like kind of take away the dependencies by just like saying that you have to do it now. So in the meanwhile, we also had lots of work with teams to, so that the teams could become independent, meaning that lots of learning need to happen as well. And that was also hard for some teams because of the pressure of the time in development teams, at least in our case, are always really very kind of big. Things need to get done really quickly, and less time there is for learning. What we also have figured out or found is, from myself, it's very interesting, is that sometimes even there is not such pressure from the business side, but developers in their head, because they are such nice people, want to give the best. So they want to do quickly, 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 without thinking that actually, maybe I should use this time now for learning. And I think there is a Finnish proverb that says that you are so busy to running next to the bicycle than to actually jump onto the bicycle to go faster. So I would say that on one point we actually had that kind of situation in our company, that we were running next to the bike. And I would say we still have kind of problem with this today as well, but we try to root it out. Regarding inspect and adapt, one of the things also that we found out is a problem that I call the problem of rotten apples. What happens with a rotten apple if it's in a bucket full of apples?
Spoil others.
Yes, and that's actually one of the things that I see, and I understand on one sense why it's hard to do, is that you actually have to get rid of rotten apples. And it doesn't necessarily mean that they have to be sent away from the company, but it might mean that this person doesn't fit for this specific team. It can be that maybe in our case there were some people who had been in a company such a long time, and I believe that they actually had the best wishes in their mind, but they just couldn't adapt with the Scrum way that we were trying to achieve in our company, and that's why they had to leave. There were some people whose positions were just changed, that they went to some other team and actually working great there. So we changed the situation because we saw that it's impossible to change the person. And I think you agree that it's hard to change someone, but we can actually change the environment around those people. And I see that in everywhere, it's people are afraid to do this. But the thing is that the longer you wait, the more rotten apples you will have. And it's really hard to change them back, basically. And I think this is also one of the things that we did, and I say that it was really good decisions that we handled at least the situation with rotten apples. Next thing that I would talk about is how to measure then that how are you doing your Scrum. So in the beginning what we did was that we looked actually manually into, we use a tool called Jira. So we looked manually into Jira and see that how different teams are doing. Also meeting with product owners and Scrum Masters. But the thing is that if you speak with the person, then the person always kind of try to make it look better. There was recently, I was looking into National Geographic one TV show where they talked, when they put person to play like a easy children game, and count, it's like that kind of game when there is like a wire and you have to go around the wire with the circle, and if it touches the wire you have to count it and tell afterwards how many times you hit it, and the goal is that you should not hit it at all. So but they were hidden camera and everybody lied. Interesting, so was that they with the next people they said that don't sit on this chair that was next to this where they were playing, and they said that people say that it belonged to some old guy who died, and it's like a ghost, like I don't believe it, but there is something about this, and in that case almost no one lied about the numbers. So But the point stays that if you don't know, we lie. That's what happens. We want to kind of make a better impression of ourselves. So after 1 year, when we had been working with this manual process, we actually started to use a tool that is called FlowHow. And it's a tool where what takes data directly from Jira, and some checks that we have here are also taken from Bamboo. So what we did was that there is a company called FlowHow who, from whom we actually bought this, and so those are all our teams, different teams, so 9 today. As you can see from the this column is total score, this is 30-day score, and this is last day score, so yesterday's score basically. And the teams that have the total score bigger means that they have been longer around. And the ones that are down here, actually, you can see that they actually have been around, like, we have created them recently, basically. And also you can see that they get less points because they just started. So we have different checks here. First one is that do they actually have a product owner? Meaning that our team members doing product owner role, our Scrum Master doing product owner role, or is actually product owner prioritizing the backlog? One thing you maybe should know also about this is that it's an indicator. So it's it doesn't, like, you cannot take this data as a pure gold, but you kind of, something that is red or is yellow, you actually need to go and ask, so what is behind this? Why is this happening? So, yeah, so for example, it might be that the product owner role is yellow or red because half of the sprint, the product owner was sick, or was in a conference, or was somewhere away. So actually there was someone who was replacing him or her. Next one is your backlog in order, meaning that do we have on top of the backlog actually estimated things? And why we have this check is that you should think ahead about your product. I know that in some cases, and we have figured out that it is much harder, especially when your product is dealing a lot with maintenance or some kind of changes that come constantly in. On that case, I would say it will be also more likely yellow. Next one is sprint cadence. And why is sprint cadence is important, of course, is that how can you know that your velocity is kind of understandable if you change all the time your sprint cadence. The next one after that is a scope change. Actually, I don't know about you, a scope change has been one of the biggest problems in our company. That all the time someone is coming too late and telling to a Scrum team that please take it in, we need it. We forgot that we actually have to, like, we have a campaign, marketing campaign going out on Wednesday, so you have to take it in and it has to be ready by that time. One of the things that I have told to Scrum Masters and product owners also is that you actually have to go back and challenge them. In a sense that, who will be guilty when this thing is late? Development team. But whose work was not done, actually? Is someone before. So it's not always only about the Scrum team. It's actually also communicating really out more to the company, telling that, hey guys, you cannot do this. Like, you need to change as well. And you have to set the boundaries. And it's hard, and it's surprisingly hard. Sometimes I'm like, how can you not just say no? Because it's not such a big deal. It's not like we are losing millions if you say no for this. But it's surprisingly hard. People are, the mindset is always pleasing the business, but actually they are working against them or undermining it. But luckily, this time we are almost green. The next one is your velocity reliable? Meaning that looking back, have you changed your sprint lengths or not? So typically our sprint length is 2 weeks. Or let's say most of the teams have 2 weeks, and then one third have 1 week sprints. Next one is reliable planning. And this is also very surprising. People always try to take in more things. This also came out when we started with, we have after every team stand-ups, we have a Scrum Master stand-up. And there we look always everybody's burn-downs. And then we see how there is like this gray line that your line should be very close, how it's actually not very close. It's quite far away, it goes up, 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 and it never really, like the sprint is not successful again. And then this check actually gives you also, everywhere here you can actually go deeper and see what's the actual numbers behind it. So here it actually gives you suggestions how many points you should take in. That does make sense. And I know that with many teams who have started to follow this, they success rate for successful sprint has improved. And then in the end we have three different checks for development, which is continuous deployment, automated tests, and continuous delivery. So all those checks are taken from Bamboo and they are connected to Jira tickets, so it's also something similar for there. And what we also do is that we, every month, in the end of every month, we have like a breakfast together with all IT, and we give out the cake who was the best in previous 30 days. And it's interesting because we didn't want this to be something that it's a goal. We wanted it to be an indicator. But if you can you believe me or not, the cake can make people to cheat. So, for example, to avoid that this will go red for scope changes, then people started to do that kind of trick that they took a story that was inside the sprint, that they saw that this will not get ready, opened it, changed the inside, and put the new story there. So that kind of things have happened. Yes, so it was surprising, and I was like, but it's about the cake, like, come on. But it seemed that the cake can be really kind of important. But of course, there is always this peer pressure, that how is your team doing? But in general, I would say that our, because the checks are coming, more new and new checks, I would say monthly, sometimes sooner, then all those things that we start to check, they actually start to improve really quickly. Because it's visible to everybody and everybody can see and understand about it. So I would say for us, very useful tool. Just to say, so why I also think that we are where we are today is this, that we sticked with the rules. We sticked with the rules of Scrum Guide, and we also created our inner rules that mostly apply to all the teams. So it's easy to also to help the teams, because we all understand things in the same way, and also people moving between different teams are not so painful, and also onboarding new people are not so painful, because everybody already know how to explain those things. So chapter 2, doing Agile. And in my mind, it's about understanding the rules. So first, you are following the rules, even so you may not understand it fully. Meaning that if you are telling your children to just, let's say about teaching someone to bake the cake. And if this person has never baked the cake, you have to teach the person really basic rules. Just like, okay, take a cup of powder, take a cup of sugar, and you don't give more extra information because it will just confuse people. And we have done that. And I know sometimes people just want to do something extra or do something different, and we say like, no, let's just follow the rules for now. The next step is when you're understanding the rules. And I would say this is the place where you can start changing the rules, because you actually understand why are you doing this. And if you understand why are you doing it, it's okay if you change those things. But about this understanding the rules, like the next step basically where we head was this, we understand that there is a fight between pigs and chickens. So I hope, or if you don't know, there is a Scrum, how it's called, pictures, something, that tells about when the chicken go to the pig and asks that, let's make a restaurant and call it bacon and eggs. And the pig was like, no, like, I will be involved, but you will be only committed, meaning that vice versa. So, well, basically, that the pig has to give like something from himself, the chicken only gives eggs. And we found out that, and the next question, who else needs to know about the rules? It's not enough when we in IT follow the rules. There are actually other people around us who actually need to know about the rules as well. And I would say the interesting part was when the countries started to say this IT this and IT that, and then I started to ask, so what this IT means to you? And it came out they actually means business, meaning that they actually meant product owners who were responsible over the backlogs. So this was one of the things that we noticed. We need to fill in the other side, like everybody basically in the company. So you cannot be agile if you don't do this to the whole company. The other thing was that we can do really good Scrum in a sense that we can have all the things in place. We can have great looking backlogs, we can have always like good rhythm in Scrumming, people always give feedback, but actually the most important, or one of the most important thing, is delivering value as soon as possible. But for this, yes, IT team can start giving feedback that, hey guys, are we checking? But actually we need the help of a business, that they actually have to understand what are their requirements. Also, the previous speakers were talking about like measuring things, I would say this is something that we still need to develop. We still have some, like a lot actually, to go there. And this brings me to the fourth question, that who else needs to follow the rules? So we have in IT the rules, but we have to expand them, and we have to kind of like go to the, so that the whole company would understand and will follow the rules. And this is much harder, as the first speaker was talking about, that if the management will be agile, it's much more scarier for them. And I would say it's also scary because so many IT companies are doing agile already, but not so many management people are doing agile. And if there is no kind of people to look up, it's hard to do. So Yes, this is something that we are currently actually struggling, and we want to improve on this area a lot. So business versus technology, and that we could be together more and fight for the same things. From what I am really happy about is that actually development teams are understanding it already. So say on their own retrospectives, more and more comes out that we don't want to do this crappy thing. We want to do things that actually bring value. We want to know what value will be beforehand, and we want to see that is this value actually delivered also. So this is something again that I am proud that people in IT already understand this. So I would say that on some level we are already in this chapter that people start to understand the rules. But the third chapter is about being agile, that you already are agile. And I was thinking that, so what it is for us or for our company, and I mean, we are far away from this. But I found this graph from Alistair Coburn homepage. How many of you have seen this? Few of you have, very good. So basically the same thing that I was talking about, Alistair has also talked about. So he calls them Shuhari and Kokoro. And the Shu level is something where you are like the first level. Just code and deliver. I would say in our case it was just do Scrum and start delivering. Just that. Don't think about anything else. We have had teams who time to time try to say like, oh, but maybe we should stop doing Kanban. We say no. Right now, follow the rules. Just think about Scrum. The next H level is when you already are like used to do those basic things and you get into the kind of problems or things that it's not enough when you do this just Scrum. For example, Scrum only gives you a framework regarding the process. But to help the team, for example, you need also XP practices. You need to start doing test-driven development. Maybe you should start doing pair programming, all different kind of things. And then you learn them. And on the V level, you can actually start kind of like juggle with them, meaning that it doesn't matter anymore. That are you do, you cannot say like I'm doing Scrum or I'm doing Kanban or I'm doing Lean, because it's all mixed. You take everything that is like better for you, and it might be really complex and really hard to explain. But then you can go even further, which is Alistair calls Kokoro, meaning that you go back to the basics. And for me, how I understood it is that if you look for the figure skaters, then if you go to skating, then it's really hard. Like in the beginning, you just like maybe learn how to turn and learn how to like do one spin and stuff like that, and it's really hard. But if you look at the professionals, then it's really easy and simple for them. But if you look at them in the practice, most likely they do also only the basic things, like they like practice the basic things. So this is something where we are all heading, and as I said, we are quite far away from it yet. But I think we are in between shu and ha, that we already are heading to the ha, but we still need to kind of stick with the rules, because not all of us understand really what the rules are. And that's it.